So in the last class, we did Grossman and Hart, where the problem of free rider was of utmost importance. And as a result of free rider problem, the value increasing takeover might face some difficulty. And one way out that was suggested by Grossman and Hart themselves was to give the dilution power to the rider, so that the dilution takes place, at least in paper. And in anticipation of that dilution, the shareholders will be forced to tender their shares, and that will help the situation in terms of some of the value increasing takeover to be successful, okay? So now we will move on to the new role that will be given to the large shareholders. So in the previous model, all the shareholders were atomistic. So they didn't have much share in the business. They are just atomistic shareholders, and each of them hold only very small amount of stake in the company. Now we are thinking of that, suppose there exists a large shareholder, then what happens? Can the large shareholder's existence facilitates the takeover process? Okay, so that is the question we are trying to ask in this paper. Now think of generally, the free rider problem is prevalent in public good contribution, and you know all of that. So here also, the public good nature of this share tendering is that there will be value improvement. Everybody is interested in that value improvement, but the people who can hold on to the share will gain. Okay, so then that tendency will lead to that everyone holds on to the shares. As a result, no value increasing takeover takes place. But here, think of any public good where the individual can benefit a lot, a particular individual, and then others will also benefit. But even if others do not contribute, then that large user of that public good can still find it worthwhile to make the investment in the public good and make it available, so that at least that person individually uses the public good and get the benefit, and the benefit might outweigh the cost of providing that public good, okay? So in such a context, you might see that a large user of public good will actually bring in some kind of public good into existence, and the others will also benefit, but others may not contribute. That doesn't hamper the provision of the public good. Think of that you are actually at the end point of a street, and you will benefit if the streets is well lit at night, and then you look at the cost of that lighting, and then you individually might feel that, okay, this is my cost, and given the benefit that I will enjoy because there are so many people who comes and visit me, and or maybe some business related activity takes place in my that factory or house, so then it is worthwhile for me to provide those street lights, okay? So you are the large user of that public good, but others who are also residing in that area, they also get the benefit of well-lit road, and they are also using it. So even if they do not contribute, you will feel like providing such kind of public good. Okay. So it is in the same spirit here. If there is a large shareholder who owns a substantial chunk of the shares, then even if the other shareholders also benefit and they do not tender their shares, but given that there will be value improvement in your own shareholder, in your own shareholding, so you might feel like tendering the shares to the raider and thereby divide the gain in some way, so that the value increasing takeover takes place. Okay, so this is the way we will be proceeding in this particular paper, and we'll see the role of large shareholder in making the takeover bid successful under certain situation. So your valuation of the state is too much. Even that you have too much valuation of the state, you yourself may like to repair the state to your liking and to the most efficient and effective way. Okay, so you being the major user of a public good might like to contribute the entire amount and get the public good in place, which other people as free rider would be able to use it, but you really don't care because you also get some benefit out of your own use, and that benefit outweighs the cost of investment that is required to make the public good available in the right condition. So the standard interpretation that you typically see in regular life also, it's not that wherever there's a public good, and even if within a bunch of people who are going to benefit collectively from a particular provision of something, it's not necessary that everybody will come forward with equal interest and contribution. So, but even then we do see in the society in many occasions that there are some certain things which is provided purely based on the personal, at personal cost, although the benefit will be appropriated by many more people, okay? So that's the idea. Now the same idea will be exploited here in this paper, where large shareholders will act as a facilitator of the raid, and as a result, the control of the firm can be taken over by the large shareholder either directly or in consultation with the raider, and so that the large shareholder actually be a party to this raid in direct or indirect manner. Okay, so there are two ways it can happen. One is that large shareholder himself can make some kind of investment in creation of value, which may be in terms of a new technology or a new idea or a new management team, which can improve the value of the firm. And if it can personally make that investment and get the value improvement visible, then it can itself move a tender offer asking all the other shareholders to contribute. Now, when the other shareholders tender their shares, these large shareholder will be able to ramp up its shares and effectively will take over the control if it can mobilize total 50% of the shares. So that's the idea of corporate control, that if you have 50% of the shares, you can control the firm. Okay, so large shareholder, imagine that it is 10% or 20%. Now this guy can actually garner another 30% of the shares, and that would bring it up to 50%. And in that case, it would be able to control the firm and bring out any value improvement that is possible with the help of this new technology or new management or whatever, the new idea, anything. Okay, so the idea is very simple, that large shareholder on his own can move a takeover bid, ask for shares from the atomistically held shareholders, and then can actually garner 50% and dislodge the manager, fire the manager, and bring in the new set of teams to improve the value. Second possibility is large shareholder can share the gain with another raider who is effectively going to move a tender offer, and there, although the rest of the shares are diffusely held, that's the assumption, but this large shareholder can make a pre-commitment that, look, you can count on my shares, I am going to tender whatever be the final price if it is above the prevailing price. Okay, so that large shareholder is not effectively behaving as the other atomistic shareholders. It is trying to facilitate the raid by an independent raider and trying to then divide the gain between the raider and the large shareholder, because large shareholders know, given its position, that if it does not tender the share, then the takeover will never be possible under this atomistically held company by the rest of the shareholders. Okay, is the idea. Large shareholder can two ways can manipulate this situation, that one is directly raiding the firm, another is facilitating a takeover which will be done by a third party. Clear? So these are some of the things which are discussed at the beginning of the paper. So these are all discussed here. So now let us go step by step with some of the basic mathematical notation and the algebra behind this. So imagine that we call large shareholder L, okay? And then L can make a value improvement investment, and that investment will lead to a probability I of drawing an improvement of positive value j from an atomless cumulative distribution function fz, okay, for a cost ci. So just focus on this. So you are making an investment ci, as a result with I probability you are able to draw an improvement, but that drop improvement is itself a random variable which is drawn from a distribution fz, and the support of the distribution is 0 to z max. Okay, so fz has the bound bounded support, that is 0 to z max. So is it clear? So imagine that I can undertake some R&D. Now when I undertake some R&D, I have some probability of success. Suppose that I call I is the probability of success. But that success does not necessarily mean a unique value to be realized. Success might mean that I am able to generate a better product or better tech kind of value of the product, which is itself is a random variable between 0 to z max. So in other words, success means that if I am able to get the draw, which is a valuation distribution between 0 to z max, okay, then I am successful, and anything between 0 to z max is a possible final draw of that valuation. So is it clear? So your R&D project yields a success if it is able to give you a positive value improvement between 0 to z max. And then this 0 to z max is itself is subject to relation with respect to a probability distribution. Okay. So that FG.
Yeah, tell me, Sneha.
So what is an atomless cumulative distribution?
Actually, these are old papers now. This is a simple cumulative distribution of continuous type. Okay. So your distribution is between 0 and z max. What is that mean by atomless is essentially we do not assign any probability on a particular value. Do you realize that continuous distribution?
Oh, okay.
Okay. And then these are the old papers, so they wrote in that fashion. Okay.
But that FZ is not dependent on the amount of investment. So the CI is the amount of investment to improve the to get the success with probability I. So if you increase your, if you want to increase your I, you have to make more investment CI, and that CI is having the following the condition on its first and second derivative. So it's basically a convex function. So in other words, if you want to improve the probability of success, you have to make more investment, and that's a convex function. Okay. So this is the idea, and the expected value from the existing management is equal to Q. So that is the status quo profit that was similar to what we consider in Grossman and Hart. Okay. So now, what is the target of this large shareholder? Large shareholder, if it invests CI, finds an improvement of value Z, which belong between 0 to Z max, okay? And if it wants to take over, it has alpha amount of shares with itself, okay? And it has to reach 0.5, that critical number. So 0.5 minus alpha amount of firm shares has to be bought by this large shareholder in order to instrument a takeover to change the manager. So is it clear? So now we also assume that the cost of takeover is CT. Okay. So now the problem is clear to you that you want to take over from diffusely held shareholders 0.5 minus alpha amount of shares, because alpha is your own holding. Okay, now what could be the advantage here? Whatever be the final value realization in terms of improvement will also be applied to your own holding. Okay, so take the very extreme case that you just need one share to reach that 0.5 mark. Okay, so suppose you hold almost 49% of the firm. So in that case, you need 1%. So even if you pay double the value of the future shares, then you are paying double the value of the future shares for that 1%, and you have your 49%. So you then get 50%, and you bring up a value improvement which is huge. So you can easily see that for that 1%, you will be too much interested to pay even double the value of the shares, okay? Because your additional value is also being applied on the 49% shareholding that you have. This is in the spirit of the same as I told you the story of the public good, that if you are a major user of the public good, you know that if you repair the street, you will benefit a lot. Your factory transport cost will go down, or some of the products that you are trying to transport will have better longevity or may not be broken on the process of transit. So in such a context, it is worthwhile for you to make the entire investment because your benefit is too much. Similarly, here, if you have the 49% shares for 1%, you will be too much willing to actually take over. Clear? Okay. So now imagine that there is a premium to take over that has to be given to the shareholder, that is pi. Okay. Now forget about that 49% thing. Now this alpha is any number between 0 to 50%. Okay. Now, if you want to garner that additional shares, which is 0.5 minus alpha, so in that case, that additional shares have to be bought from the market. And when you buy that from the market, the shareholders will have expectation that in the future, this guy might have an improvement, and based on that improvement, it will actually make the changes in management, and final value will be realized. Okay. And in that case, I will get some number which is over and above Q. So imagine that additional amount is pi. Now this pi is 0.5 z minus 0.5 minus alpha into pi minus ct must be greater than zero. So what does this mean? This tells you that if the large shareholder is able to make a profit after paying for the takeover cost and after paying the premium on the shares that it has to garner 0.5 minus alpha. So deducting, netting these two costs of taking over, and then finally it would be ending up with 0.5 shareholding, and Z will be its improvement in value. So these particular expressions would be greater than equal to 0 to for the takeover to be feasible at the premium pi that is given to the shareholder. So is it clear? So the large shareholder will find it profitable to take over after paying the premium pi, provided that this condition holds. Okay. So now, because of this prospect of value increasing takeover that is going to happen, so here what is being talked about that the market price might divert. So we'll talk about it slightly later. Okay. So this pi is essentially the premium over and above the Q. Okay. Now in anticipation of the takeover, the share that is being traded in the stock market may not be the Q because people will expect some improvement. So the existing trading price in the market may be somewhere in between Q and Q plus pi. So that is being talked about here.
Sir. Now, sir, here in this equation one, in inequality, like Q has been cancelled out. Like we have given pi amount, we have given them Q plus pi. So
yes. So essentially, if you remember from Grossman-Hart, we are only concentrating on value increasing takeover. There are cases of hostile takeover where actually value of the shares goes down after the takeover, but we are not considering those kind of takeover. Okay. So in other words, the existing shareholders have to be assured of the status quo profit Q. So additional amount that we are focusing on, and the additional amount, how much to be given in order to take over. So that's the focus. Okay. But otherwise, you can also see that it is possible to construct situation where the
existing shareholders profit will not be retained in a sense that they might be forced to trade below the Q price. Okay, so that you can create a situation something like that, but we are not talking about that. We are restricting ourselves in the value increasing takeover, these particular dimensions, if you can see this. Okay, so that's the idea for this set of takeover papers. Okay, so now this J is not known to the small shareholders. Okay, now the small shareholders has to form some expectation about this J, that how much is the J and what could be the possible value of the J. Now the small shareholder form the expectation based on these two pieces of information. Yale has drawn an improvement from FZ. Okay, so Yale is successful. That means that it has drawn something, a J from FZ distribution, and L can cover takeover cost and pay 0.5 minus alpha pi above Q and still make a non-negative profit, because if it makes a negative profit here, then that particular type of raider will not raid. Okay, so the small shareholders best forecast of J, that how much is the J conditional on that they observe a takeover bid, is the following: that expectation J conditional on that 0.5 Z minus 0.5 minus alpha pi minus CT is greater than equal to zero. So this is exactly equation one, that raid is feasible, is profitable for the raider to do. Okay, so this expectation of Z will be the forecast of the Z. Okay, now so you have to calculate the conditional expectations, not that all possible J realization will be allowed for this takeover to be feasible. For example, if you have positive cost CT and if your J is very close to zero, then you know that with minus CT, a fixed amount, it is not possible to satisfy for J very close to zero this particular expression, even if pi is zero, right? Pi is the premium over and above the existing share price. So even if you don't pay anything extra to the shareholders, if your J is very, very close to zero, then essentially you would not be able to take over because of the fixed takeover cost CT, which is a positive amount. Clear? So this conditional expectation is extremely important in terms of forming the expectation of J conditional on that takeover is successful. And this indirectly will feed into the premium pie that is acceptable to the shareholders, because shareholders are forming expectations based on this particular J. And if they are paid according to these expectations, then only they will tender their shares. So this pie premium that the large shareholder has to give is something to do with this particular expression. Okay. So now tendering is the best strategy, provided that this particular expression, what you get, you can simplify that. Okay. So this pi that is being offered and the forecast of the small shareholders expectation J, given that J greater than, this is simply the number. This is simply the simplified expression of this particular expression. So this is greater than or equal to zero. So if and only if this particular thing is greater than or equal to zero, then small shareholders, based on their expectation of J and conditional on pi being offered to them, they will be happy to tender their shares. Okay, and they will also tender their shares whenever they are indifferent, and by which we are coming close to a situation that we will be able to get the minimum possible pi, okay, at which this expression is equal to zero. Okay, so which means that shareholders are tendering their shares even at that minimum premium pi star. Okay, and that we denote by pi star alpha. So pi star alpha is the minimum pi that satisfies two. So is it clear? Let me pause and you just get ready with your question for a four within 30 seconds.
Any question?
Hello?
Sir, I just had a question. Can you please explain this equation number 2 once more?
Yes. So imagine that you have to think about the possible value improvement of your share. Now, possible value improvement of your share is based on that guy will be successful in getting some Z, okay? And it is going to take over the farm. So not only that all Z will do, but the Z and netting for the takeover cost will be able to get a positive profit after paying some premium pi, okay? So this is the right hand side. So this is the expectation about the future value improvement that is possible by these large shareholders, okay? Subject to that this pi, which is figuring in this expression as well as to the outside it. So this pi is essentially the premium that the shareholders would be willing to tender their shares at that price. So that has to be given by the large shareholder. So this particular 1 minus 2 alpha and all has come from this expression. Okay, so that's pretty simple. So now this is your expectation of value. Now when will you tender your shares? When your expectation of the value is exactly greater than equal to what is being offered to you today. Okay, so if you are offered greater than that particular expected value, conditional on the fact that many things are happening, okay, so but you know that in expected sense that would be my value tomorrow. Okay, now if that would be my value tomorrow, so if I want to part with my shares today, I will, and forgetting about the discount factor, I would at least expect that amount. So that is exactly your equation too, that this pi must be greater than equal to the expectation Z, conditional on Z greater than this. Okay. So this is your condition too. Now what we are trying to say pi star alpha is the minimum pi at which this is satisfied with equality. And our assumption is that whenever the shareholders are indifferent between their expected value about tomorrow's value of their shares and today's offer from the large shareholder, that is pi, the additional amount, when they are equal, even then they will be willing to tender. Okay, so that is the assumption we are making. So essentially whenever there's a tie in terms of indifference between the two actions by the small shareholders, they will work in favor of the large shareholders and tender their shares. Okay, so this pi star alpha is the minimum premium that has to be given to the small shareholder, which will then fetch all the shares that the large shareholders need, okay, at that price. So is it clear?
Yes, sir.
You imagine any asset that you hold, and you imagine that land example I gave, tomorrow there will be a factory, your land price will go up. Now what would be your price at which you want to sell? You at least want that particular price to be given what would be the price tomorrow. This is exactly this expression. Now I am saying that I will give you the minimum which will make you the indifferent, so that pi star alpha is exactly that amount. So is it clear? And all these are formed in terms of expectations about the known information. Known information is the object distribution, okay? And all these other parameters that are known in the model. So for example, alpha is also known and all that, okay? Clear?
Hello, sir. Sir, I have a question. Yeah. Sir, in equation one, why are we not considering the cost of investment? Is it like because it, once incurred, it's a sunk cost, or what's the reason for that?
Yeah. So you are very right. So if you look at the entire paper, there are many stages of the game that is happening. Now, after investment, after value realization, this entire story of takeover unfolds. Okay. So all these things are the decisions of the past, and it has no bearing on the present. So now the question is that after that jade being realized, whether the guy is able to take over or not,
if they take over, what would be the price and all that. Now this game will be then folded back as in the framework of that typical finite period game, the way it is folded back. Okay, so then we will be looking into the amount of investment that will be made and all that. Okay, so that would be the first stage problem. But now we are looking at a sub game. Okay.
Yes, sir. Got it. Thank you.
So we are now looking at the sub game where the takeover is being considered and at what price takeover is a feasible option and happening. So pi star alpha is the minimum price. So that's important to note. Okay. So now, if that pi star alpha is given, then you know that based on the belief that is being formed, given by A and B, so those two pieces of information, then we'll be able to get pi star alpha from here. Okay. So is it clear? So now, the issue is the following. Issue is that we'll be trying to characterize the final outcome in terms of the takeover premium, the market valuation of the shares and all that. So this is the main theorem which will be proved, and this theorem will be proved with the help of few lemmas. Okay. So what is the theorem? When tender offer must be made for exactly 0.5 minus alpha shares and pi star alpha is less than z max, remember that pi star alpha can never be equal to z max or greater than, because pi star alpha is the premium that has to be paid to the shareholders and z max is the maximum valuation that the reader, the large shareholder will be able to draw. Okay. So this has to be less than z max. There's a unique pure study sequential equilibrium. I call it perfect Bayesian equilibrium rather than sequential equilibrium, because although they are very closely related, but call it perfect Bayesian equilibrium. They are mostly equivalent in most of the examples, only in some peculiar cases they are different. So you are not bothered about that right now. So this is the perfect Bayesian equilibrium and is supported by out of equilibrium belief that is needed. Okay. That are credible in the sense of Grossman and Perry. So you don't need to bother about that. So your belief has to be based on those few considerations that you have learned in your game theory. Okay. So wherever possible, that has to be based on the Bayesian updation and all that. If you remember those requirements and the refinements of the perfect Bayesian equilibrium. Okay. So L bids Q plus pi star alpha if this is greater than zero and does not bid otherwise. So in other words, this part is pretty simple, straightforward, that if it is not greater than equal to zero, obviously the reader will not be able to make any profit, then it would not be. Now, if this is greater than zero, they will bid. And if they bid, how much they will pay? Now look, the reader is floating the tender. And if they float the tender, they fix the price and ask everybody that whether they are willing to tender their shares. So they will fix the price at pi star alpha. Okay, the minimum possible at which this is possible to the amount of shares is possible to be obtained. Now, these are some of the comparative statics and these are helpful in terms of establishing this particular proposition. Okay, so one thing is clear that this is innocuous. In a sense, you know that if it is profitable, they will do it. And main issue is that whether pi star alpha or more should be demanded by the shareholders. Now, the way take it or leave it offer kind of situation we are imagining. So the tender offer will be floated by the large shareholder. So it will simply quote a price that at this price, if you are willing, just tender your share. Okay. And we have not mentioned one important aspect, that there is conditional and unconditional bidding. Now, conditional bidding tells you that I am floating a tender of garnering say 0.5 minus alpha amount of shares. Okay. Now I'm saying that, okay, I have 10%. I am looking for 40% shares. Now I am floating the tender and then everybody is saying that yes or no, whether they would like to tender or not. Now, if I am not able to get that 40% I can return all the shares to the shareholder. So this is, in a sense, this is known as conditional tender offer. So conditional means that if I'm able to get my critical mass, then I will take your shares, otherwise I will return the shares. Because shares are just a paper which defines the ownership on the farm. Okay, so it is not that after taking you and with me, I am just doing any damage to that particular thing. So you are still the owner, but provided that I am able to get 40%, then only I will take your shares and you transfer the shares in my name. So that's the conditional bidding. Another unconditional bidding is that it does not matter whether you are getting 40% or not. Once you float a tender offer, if anybody comes to you, the deal has to be struck then and there at that price. So in other words, whether you are able to get 50% or 100% or not, that is not that is not binding. So legally, if you are in the unconditional tender offer, so then essentially you start gathering your shares depending on the arrival and you have to buy on the spot. Okay. And you cannot make it conditional on other people surrendering or tendering the shares. Clear? So here what we are assuming is that these are all conditional share, the conditional bidding. So in a sense that if I do not get 0.5 minus alpha, I am not going to accept or pay you the money. Okay. I will return the shares that you have submitted to me. So now lemma one is very important. Pi star alpha is decreasing in alpha. And what is pi star alpha? Pi star alpha is the premium. Now pi star alpha is the premium over and above the Q. Okay. So this is closely related to the second lemma. Zc alpha is strictly decreasing in alpha. Okay. So now you read it thoroughly, but let me handle the two things together. Okay. So the idea in terms of the proof is the following. Pi star alpha is decreasing. What is pi star alpha? Pi star alpha is the minimum premium price that I have to give to the shareholders so that they are agreeable to tender the shares. Okay. Now suppose my alpha goes up in a comparative static sense. If I am the larger shareholder, then what would be my interest? My interest will be to take over. But when I take over, given the fixed cost, everything, every other thing is fixed and alpha has gone up. So you can see from the simple expression of profit that if alpha goes up, okay, if this particular alpha goes up, the right side z greater than equal to this, so this particular term goes down, right? Because alpha has gone up. Now, if this particular term goes down, then I am interested in taking over for z, which are lower values even. Because I am taking over for all z greater than some critical number, and let us call this zc alpha, because this particular value I call it zc, z critical, and alpha is a function which affects zc, so I call it zc alpha. So as alpha goes up, you can easily see that my zc alpha is decreasing, right? Because of the strict sense that z has to be greater than equal to 1 minus 2 alpha, that pi and all that particular expression plus 2 ct. Okay, so this particular expression tells you that zc alpha is a decreasing function of alpha. Okay, so I'll be able to take over even for zc alpha goes down, so even for lower value realization z, I'll be able to take over. Then what does that mean? That means that in my expectation calculation, some of the lower values are coming into play now as alpha goes up. Okay. Now, given that they are drawn from a master distribution, I don't know master is the right word or not. So FZ distribution, and then based on the conditional distribution that Z greater than some critical value, I'm calculating the expectation. And now as alpha goes up, my ZC alpha falls. So for larger Z zone, I am forming my expectation. And what are the values I'm including? I'm including the lower values of J, which means these particular expectations will now have a lower value. Okay. And that essentially imply what would be my pi star alpha, because pi star alpha would then go down, right? Because this is holding with equality, okay, at pi star alpha. So pi star alpha will go down. Is it clear or not? Pi star alpha is decreasing in alpha. Is it clear or not? Tell me. If you understand, this is very simple. If you don't, then it's very difficult. Imagine that there is asymmetric information. Imagine that you do not know what kind of Z I have, but now you are forming your expectation, but you know that if I have a very large share on of my own, that means alpha is large, close to 49. You know that by even for a small value improvement, given that that is applied on the 49% shares, and given CT, which is fixed, I would be more inclined to take over. Now, if I am more inclined to take over, that is reflected in that even with lower Z, I will take over. Now, your formation of expectation is based on, there's a distribution of Z, which is 0 to Z max, and you have a distribution function given FZ. Okay, so now you are including more lower values because I am willing to take over even for those values. So then what would be your expected Z conditional on that ZC itself goes to the left? It will go down. If it goes down, your pi star alpha falls. So the lemma one and lemma two, they go in tandem, and they basically reflect the two sides of the same problem. Clear? Okay, now we'll go one stage backward and look at what would be the large shareholders' interest in terms of making the investment in value improvement and what would be the associated benefit of it. So imagine now that this is the benefit function of the large shareholder when it makes the investment with alpha as its own holding. So now, this is the probability of getting the value improvement. If you get the value improvement Z, which will again belong to that 0 to Z max, and obviously you are interested in looking at the benefit only for values where this particular expression gives you positive number. Okay, so this I is the probability that some value of Z will be realized. So what is that value? That value could be anything between 0 to Z max. Then the second thing, the benefit, you know that up to 0 to ZC alpha, you are not taking over. So essentially, you are not getting any benefit due to this particular investment in R&D or whatever the process innovation that you are doing. Okay. But your value will be positive if this particular value is positive, and that will happen only for Z greater than ZC alpha. Okay, so in that case, there will be some additional benefit that you will get. So expectation of max of these two numbers defines your benefit conditional on that some value improvement has been obtained. Clear? Okay, so this is the benefit function, and if this is the benefit function and we know that the pi star alpha is the expected value of an improvement conditional on takeovers being profitable, okay, so that is there and which is already embedded in this expression. So now let us break it up. We are trying to break it up, this particular expression, expectation max of this. Now, expectation max of this can be written as we are bringing in the operator and applying it on this expression. Okay, so now you can easily see that if the operator it gets here,
then 0.5 expectation z, okay? And we know that pi star alpha is expectation z conditional on takeover is profitable, which is again the same expression greater than zero, okay? So this 0.5 z here, 0.5 expectation z here, and 0.5 pi star alpha here, they will cancel out. Minus and minus will be plus. So you will have alpha as the remaining term, and into this pi star alpha is nothing but expectation z conditional on z greater than zc alpha minus ct, okay? So that's the takeover cost, okay? So this will be your benefit, but this benefit will accrue subject to the condition that you are making the takeover, and you are making the takeover with probability that z is greater than zc alpha. So you have a fz distribution, you are looking at the right hand side of that zc alpha, okay? The overall probability of z belonging to zc alpha and z max. So the probability of that is this, and given that you are paying based on, because this is a rational expectation equilibrium, remember partite Bayesian equilibrium, so entire thing has to be valid in the current context, okay? So this should be the probability that at which some z will be realized, which is to the right of zc alpha. If that happens, then I will have this much value due to takeover minus the takeover cost ct, okay? And so that's my benefit, but this overall benefit will be with the probability of successful R&D I. So this is my total benefit, okay? So now what happens to the behavior?
Sir, may you go back again on this equation, like expected value of maxima of like,
be louder please, I'm not getting your voice clearly.
Sir, the equation expected value of maximum 0.5 z minus this, as you explained.
So I'm saying that this operator expectation, you just bring it inside, okay, on this particular term. So 0.5 expectation z minus 0.5 minus alpha, this alpha pi star alpha is nothing but expectation z conditional on z greater than zc alpha, okay? And you are operating these expectations only when this part is positive, so that itself is z greater than zc alpha, this from this expression. So I have 0.5 expectation z, and here also 0.5 expectation z conditional on z greater than zc alpha. So both these terms will cancel out. I will be only left with alpha expectation z, given that z greater than zc alpha. Okay? And minus ct is the cost of takeover. So this will be my overall benefit. But this overall benefit will accrue to me, provided that I get again a value improvement which is to the right of zc alpha, and I have a overall probability of that particular value improvement. So imagine you have a uniform distribution between 0 to 1, and you will be able to tell me what would be the probability that my x is greater than equal to 0.3. you'll be able to tell me that. I'm using that probability. So with that probability, this particular value improvement can be obtained by the large shareholder. Is it clear?
Yes.
Because this guy doesn't know when it is making the investment that what z will be occurring, and it will only know about the distribution. So for him also the calculation is expected calculation. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, only at the subgame when the takeover is actually taking place, then you know the z, other guys do not know the z, and you are making a bid only when your z is greater than zc alpha, otherwise not. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now given that this will be the benefit that will accrue to the
large shareholder, okay, so this is I into expectation this, and we have already elaborated that expectation max of this can be simply written as this, okay. So now from here, we'll try to look at what happens if alpha changes. Now, L's optimal choice of research intensity, I star alpha, is increasing in alpha. Now, first note that this is my benefit. Okay, so if this is the benefit, I need to look at the cost of investment, that is CI, okay. Where is that? They may not have given it. Okay, so come here. So you do not need to go through all the points, but you just come here. So this is my benefit. What happens to my benefit if alpha goes up? If alpha goes up, alpha into expectation z, z greater than zc alpha minus ct, probability z greater than zc alpha. Okay, so if alpha goes up, this particular expression is applied on I. Okay, so what would be, suppose I now define my net benefit to the large shareholder z, z will be bi alpha minus ci. Clear? Ci is the cost of investment. Now I am trying to choose I, okay. Now when I try to choose I will be simply taking del z del I, okay, and I will make it equal to zero, assuming that every function behaves well and I have some interior, so I will have faster condition. Clear? Okay, now faster condition has two components. When I take the derivative with respect to I, this particular expression is the marginal benefit of increasing I, right? Clear? And minus ci, c dash I will be the marginal cost of investment I, and they will be equalized at I star. Clear? Just write z equal to bi alpha minus ci and take del z by del I, you will be able to find out the faster condition. Now the question is that if my alpha affects this particular marginal returns, okay, marginal returns, if this goes up, then you know that given the convexity of the cost function, so your point of equilibrium will be to the right, okay, so I will go up. Clear? So in your entire life, you have done plenty of optimization. You are not able to find out that if I have some kind of concave function and a convex function, I am trying to maximize the difference between the two, how my optimal value changes with respect to any change that is there. So in other words, z faster condition will give you I star, and my claim is as alpha goes up, this particular expression goes up, as a result you will be moving towards the right and your I star will go up. Okay, draw the diagram if you are not able to do it. So draw some diagram. So here it is not possible. So some kind of, how do I do it, draw it. Draw some kind of this function and another like this function, okay. So this is my cost function. So you will be able to see that if my marginal benefit goes up, okay, so then where do I actually get my I? So when this becomes steeper, so then you will be able to see that your optimal investment go to the right. Okay, clear?
So this is how entire optimization proceeds. So now the question is that as alpha changes, my I star alpha goes up because my marginal benefit is going up. Okay. Oh, maybe I assume z equal to bi alpha minus ci. That's why. So imagine why. So I abruptly I assume that the benefit is z. No. So imagine this is some y here equal to bi alpha minus ci. Okay, then you will be able to optimize and get the value. Sorry about that. So you should have said that z is denoting something else in the model. So now the question is that I star alpha goes up. So which means that if I have large shareholder in the already existing firm, if alpha goes up, I will have more interest in investing in the value increasing technology. Okay, so my I will go up, and that's natural. If you are unable to understand, if you have more share in a particular company, all the essential interest will be more for you. And if it is not, then you are not the right shareholder. Okay, so these are some interpretations given. Now to explore the implication of this result, we write the market value of the firm. So now this is another dimension. We have to now look at what is the market value of the firm in anticipation of a takeover and what would be the takeover premium. And look that market value of the firm will depend on the existing status quo profit Q plus the potential increase in value of the firm. Now the entire expression is the potential increase in the value of the firm. Okay, that every shareholders or the trader in the stock market will be able to understand that the following additional increment of the value is possible. Now what is this additional value increment? I star alpha is the probability that some improvement takes place. Into 1 minus ZC alpha is the probability that Z lies to the right of ZC alpha. Third is expectation Z, that what is the expected value of those values of Z. Okay. So this gives you the potential increment in value figure. Now stock market being forward looking, they will anticipate all this behavior even for the large shareholders. So the market value of the firm will be V alpha Q, which will be Q plus this additional number. Is it clear? This is simple forward looking behavior which dictates that this is going to happen. Okay. And imagine that all our parties and everybody is risk neutral. So we have not bothered to have risk cluttering our way for our results. So now the question is the following. This is the market value of the firm and how much L is making a payment to the shareholder. It is paying a payment which is only this part of the forget about 1 minus I star alpha. L is only making a payment which is based on this expected value. Right? 1 minus FZ C alpha. Okay. So this is the expected payment that the shareholders are getting, expectation Z, given that Z greater than ZC alpha. Is it clear? So the conditional on that value improvement has taken place. This is the amount, so leaving aside 1 minus I star alpha, this is the amount what the shareholders are expected to get by holding on to the share. Okay, so then this
value is being paid to the shareholder minus this additional value was already prevailing in the market. Okay, the difference between the two, is exactly what the additional amount the AL is paying. Is it clear? So status quo value Q is there, and we are entirely doing the exercise only on the incremental value. And in the incremental value, we are looking at that how much L is paying to the large share, sorry, to the small shareholders when it actually moved the tender offer and takes the shares. Okay, so it is offering some price, but when that price is offered, at that price the shareholders are tendering their shares and the takeover is being successful. But the issue is, what was the prevailing market rate before that? Prevailing market rate before that was this particular overall amount. So Q plus this, that means this I plus, this was the additional amount that was already in the market. So the market value of the shares was already ramped up by this particular amount. Okay. However, the large shareholder is only offering this additional amount. So the difference between the two is the premium that the large shareholder is making a payment to the small shareholders. Okay. And if you look at this premium, then premium falls as alpha rises. Now, as alpha rises, we know that it has multiple effect. Okay, first is what is happening to the I star alpha in this expression. As alpha rises, I star alpha goes up, right? I star alpha is an increasing function of alpha. Okay, so this goes down, and we also know that ZC alpha falls, right? Okay, so 1 minus FZC alpha, this goes up. So this goes down, first term goes down, this term goes up, and this is the expectation of the Z which is above ZC alpha. Okay, so now I am making the following claim and you tell me whether you understand it or not. My claim is that I am shifting the ZC towards the left. So I have one direct effect which is affecting my this expression. But I have another indirect effect because lower values are already included. So my average value will fall. But my claim is that average value will fall slowly than the stretch of inclusion of that Z. So overall, these two will move in the downward direction. So this multiplied by this will go down because this average does not change so swiftly as the probability will be changing, because you are only allowing lower Z values to be included, given that there are higher Z values already. So it is not easily dragging down. So these two terms together will go down. Sorry, I am saying the opposite.
Sir, it should go up.
It should go up, okay? Acha. So this is going up, this is going down. So these two, apart from this first term, this is going up or down. Expectation Z is falling. This is going up, right? Okay, so this is going up, this is going down. So overall, this should go up and this is going down. So this total is, as per the claim, is going down. Okay, so lemma 4 tells you about this part. 1 minus f zc alpha expectation z, z greater than zc alpha is increasing in alpha. So that part is consistent with our discussion. So this is going up. This part is, oh, sorry, I was misinterpreting this. Sorry. This is going up, okay? But this bracket is not closed here. I was thinking that bracket is closed here. So 1 minus I star alpha into this term. So given that this is going up and I star alpha is there, so even if I star alpha remains the same, this overall thing is going down, right? And on top of that, we know that I star alpha, as alpha goes up, I star alpha itself is also going up. So overall, 1 minus the entire thing, this is larger value. So as a result, this is going to fall. Clear? Sorry, I misunderstood that there is a bracket here. So it was not, there is no bracket here.
So can you explain why the expectation falls more slowly?
This is very simple. So just imagine any distribution. Think of 0, 1 with uniform distribution, okay? Now, if you are trying to, so what would be the 0, 1 uniform distribution? What would be the expected value? Half, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now you think of between 0, 1, take any point, 0.3. 0.3 to 1, what would be the expected value? If I have the random variable between 0.3 to 1, what would be the expected value? Is it difficult?
0.65,
right? So now you just shift it 0.3 to 0.2. And then look at the expected value changes. And then apply this particular multiplication. And then you will see that as you are going down, including more and more lower values, but your average does not fall that sharply. Okay, so that gives you why lemma 4 is true. Okay, clear? Just apply on this example and look at this expression. And then you will be able to convince that average does not fall so drastically as you keep on adding the lower values of the distribution, okay? Convincing or not?
Yes, sir, I got it.
I think that many of the things are not so difficult in terms of conceptualization, although proof is necessary for most of the things, but this is just simple common sense, okay? I introduce something which are of lower values, the average doesn't fall that drastically. But given that I have introduced that, so my stretch changes and all that, okay? So clear, so these four lemmas actually give you the first theorem, okay? Now I have, so do I have another 10 minutes or so, or you have some class now? Do you have any class right now?
We do have a class.
At what time?
10.
Okay, so in the next class also, we will be discussing a little bit about the last point, okay? And do you have any question as of now? Do you have any question?
No, sir.
Okay, so read it very carefully. It's not difficult paper. It's very interesting, but you have to go step by step in terms of this expression. Okay, and I don't know why sometimes the simple average and this also creates confusion. At least that has happened. So anyway, so again, then tomorrow we'll be discussing. From here and then move on to the next day. Okay, so we are closing the session for.
Thank you, sir.